Hey, Yahweh.
We only reverence one stripper, and that's the one that took off glory to put on humanity and then get butt naked on a cross to die for both you and me.
It's been well said, where reverence withers, worship suffers. And those words should both haunt and motivate the Christian church right now, because we have a reverence issue. This culture is one that's been raised on entertainment, soaked with irreverence for authority, driven by whatever's popular, and sucked in by emotionalism. So many people today, too many people, walk into church services thinking, if it feels good, it looks good, it sounds good, well, then it must be good, never being taught to understand or discern otherwise. But worse than that, many popular preachers today would argue, if we want the world to come to church, then we should make the church look and feel like the world. But since when is the church's primary calling to conform to this world in order to win people to Christ? Isn't it that we call the culture, the world, to conform to Christ instead? We need to wake up and make the church a place of reverent worship again, where the Holy Spirit is submitted to, where Christ is worshiped, and where God the Father is glorified. If we want the world to change, and we most certainly do, we need to stop changing the church to make it look like the world. Here are four examples on this episode of Filtered that we should filter through Scripture. First up, Bianca Olthoff, pastor of the Father's House in Orange County, California.
I invited Jesus to my wedding. DJ, hit me with what Jesus would roll in with his disciples. Yes! Hey, Yahweh! All right, all right, that's my Jesus. That's my Jesus. And religious people are like, how dare you? He would never dance. Because the vision that you have of Jesus is him on a cross. And he did go to the cross. He did die for our sins, but he also danced for our freedom. This is the humanity and the divinity that we see.
This is a classic example of what a lot of preachers do today, cueing the tech team to drop some song, which, by the way, most of us in our BC days before Jesus saved us used to dance in clubs to that kind of garbage, and make an illustration of it. Before you can even think about being bothered by it, though, she makes sure to shame religious folks who might actually expect reverence in the church. Now, I don't personally believe in women pastors, but even if we left that theological argument aside for just a moment, no one claiming to be a pastor should be carrying on this way in a pulpit. Her Jesus, based on the songs she selected for him, would apparently dance to a song loaded with filthy lyrics, including the N-word. We need to think before we do this kind of stuff in the pulpit. And you, if you attend a church like that, or maybe you even go to that church, ought to think twice before attending a church where, even if you're somewhat fed spiritually, it comes with a side dish of godless paganism. Second, we have Tim Ross, a pastor who actually says a lot of true things and pushes hard on some key issues, but like many in this generation, fails to grasp the way God would have his mouthpieces present truth, speak about his son, or lead the worship of his holy name. This is him blasphemously referring to Jesus in ways that no preacher ever should.
We don't make it rain on booty cheeks. We don't make it rain on strippers. We only reverence one stripper, and that's the one that took off glory to put on humanity and then get butt naked on a cross to die for both you and me. The only stripper I'm in love with is Jesus. And he's the one that puts that bread in my pocket. That bread in my pocket.
I got bread in my pocket. I got bread in my pocket.
I got bread in my pocket.
I got bread in my pocket.
It does not matter how clever your illustration is or how edgy you think you can get or how much you think the crowd is into what you're saying. The Holy Spirit is grieved by that type of preaching and that presentation. Reverence for Jesus matters. Worship of Jesus matters. And how you present him in the pulpit matters. Third, we have Michael Todd and Transformation Church with their Easter service that we'll only run a few short clips of because it looks more like a demonic ritual than anything we would ever find in a biblical church. Here's a sampling of what they presented on Easter Sunday this year. You know, recently a few churches right here in the Phoenix area were livid that our ministry would call out Michael Todd, saying he's influential and people calling out this kind of blasphemy are just throwing stones and they're going against the body of Christ and being divisive. Friends, like frogs in water slowly being boiled, so many church leaders are sadly under a spirit of delusion and only the truth can set them free. Finally, not to be outdone, Church by the Glades has a huge menu of Sunday worship sets to pull from, including their Stormtrooper version. And yes, unfortunately, this is actually a part of their worship service, and I would not even call it that.
Yeah, wait. What is that?
Why'd they change the music?
Wait a minute.
Look at these little Stormtroopers.
Did you plan this?
I didn't plan it. What are they doing out here?
What's most concerning about a church like that is 42% of their attendance is millennials, according to a recent study, which I'm generationally a part of. We have young kids. We're upwardly mobile, if you will, working hard. We're voting. We have opinions, and we're shaping Gen Z and beyond. So with a total of some 9,000 in weekend attendance at Church by the Glades, a ton of millennials, another 5,000 at Transformation Church with Michael Todd in person, and then another 20,000 or so watching their weekly sermons, add online resources, extrapolate that out to how many other congregations and megachurches are doing it like them, and what you have is a very sobering reality. That reverence is out the window in our culture, our church culture. Influence is in, and however you act or preach or what you say doesn't matter as long as it gets results and can be presented in some quasi-spiritual way. Friends, if you are not equipped to speak to these issues and you're a church leader, it is time to step up. So how do we filter this through Scripture? It's pretty simple if we let the Bible plan the worship service. Now, in what order we do the things I'm about to tell you is flexible, but what the church does is clear in Scripture. We preach the Bible, we read the Bible, we pray the Bible, we sing the Bible, and we see the Bible. Preach the Bible can be from 2 Timothy 4:2, where Paul says to Timothy, preach the word. Read the Bible can be from 1 Timothy 4:13, where he says, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Pray the Bible can be from 1 Timothy 2:8, where we read, therefore, I want the men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension. That's a call to pray when the church is gathered and to have a reverent and unified attitude where holiness is emphasized and there's no room for worldly practices when such things are prioritized. Sing the Bible can be from Colossians 3:16, where Paul writes, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to the Lord. He goes on to write, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Is what we're doing and how we're conducting our worship services in line with the name of Jesus? Is that how he modeled ministry for us? Clearly, the church should sing the Bible, dwell on the word of Christ, and not pagan songs or filthy worldly word pictures. See the Bible can be from the way the church baptizes and takes communion or the Lord's table. This is the gospel on display, Christ's death and resurrection clearly understood, and what that means for the believer. Perhaps the best way to filter through all of the unbiblical presentations of church that we're seeing in today's culture is to remind you that the church is actually not for unbelievers. It is for believers. That truth is rooted in a doctrine called ecclesiology, which is the biblical study or the biblical doctrine of the church and its purposes. The church in the Bible is often called saints, which in the New Testament is the Greek word hagios, meaning holy, set apart, and consecrated. Therefore, when the church gathers, it needs to be reverent and holy. We seek to glorify God, and that can take on different flavors, and it certainly matters what context you're in. Perhaps if you're in a culture here in America or in an African culture or Asian culture, yes, there are things that will be different, but the core elements of the church service should all come from Scripture. David, in the Old Testament, did not warm up his harp playing the latest pagan tunes. Peter did not employ filthy lyrics and dance moves to get his audience to vibe with his sermon. And while Paul the Apostle said he would become all things to all men to win some and save more, he wasn't saying he'd employ sinful language or lewd imagery and paganism to get people to come hear him preach, but that he would lay down his liberties to do whatever he needed to do and sacrifice whatever he had to in order to reach the lost. Friends, remember this. The church is a family gathering, and yes, we're expecting guests. By all means, seek to invite the lost and pray that they would come, but never forget, the church is still on planet Earth to call the culture to conform to Christ, not the other way around.